One of the big development targets for Project Mango was to have a new and multi-threaded, much faster compositor. And thanks to Jeroen Bakker, who has been working on that for the last year, we have that now. And it's not that different at first glance, but under the hood, everything is new. So it has been recoded from scratch. It's now much faster. And it also does have a few new features. And I'm going to show you that quickly. So first, if you go to the compositor, then well, it doesn't look really different at first, but under the hood it is much faster. I think with a simple cube file I can really not demonstrate how much faster it is, but later I will open up a file that is a bit more complicated, and there you can hopefully see that it is quite a bit faster. Anyway, so you still have the old interface, so you can press N to bring up the sidebar. But one of the new things that you can see here is the performance tab, and I'm going to talk about that later. So basically it's still the same, but if you press Shift A, then there are a few new things. For example, you can now search for notes. I think this has been coded by Lukas Tönne. So if you press the search item, or just press S for search, then you can now search for example, color, and then color ramp, spill, matte, or balance, color correction, stuff like that. So that's very handy. You can press Shift A to bring up the menu, and then Shift AS. So Shift AS is the search, and then viewer, and then you can add a new viewer node. So, or because I've just deleted the composite, you can just press that composite, and then you have the new composite output. So that's very handy. But also there are a few new nodes. And one of them is the bokeh blur. So if you control shift click here to the render layer, you can see now the output. And if you want to have a nice bokeh blur, which means you could have a custom shape for the bokeh, you can go to filter and then add down there the bokeh blur. And if I drag that between here, then we do have this bokeh effect, which still isn't that apparent. So maybe go here, duplicate this cube to make some smaller highlights, and then add a new material maybe, and this could be shadeless, just to test, render that. So now I have this little thing up here, and now you can add a bokeh image. That means you can have a custom shape for the blur, and you can find that if you go to input and then here bokeh image, bring that in here. And now you can have a custom shape for that. So if I make the size bigger to make it even more blurry, now this also takes a while, it's much blurrier, but now you can see the shape of that. And then the other thing is then you can tweak the shape, and we made use of that because it's very fun to do. For example, you can have lens shift to add some chromatic aberration to the shape. Maybe that's a bit too much. So a little bit should be enough. And then the other thing is you can have a custom amount of flaps. So that would be the shutter blades of the camera that this is being simulating. You can add some rounding to that. And one nice effect, which we noticed we had on our actual camera on set, is the catadioptric effect. And that will add this little hole in the middle. And depending on the blur and depending on the on your image, you can see that. So maybe in this case it's hard to see, but if I make this bigger, then I will have this black hole in the middle of the blur. And we did have that on the actual footage. So we were seeing all these little holes in the blurry highlights of our footage. And then, yeah, that is this. So this is the bokeh image. And of course you can make it smaller as well, like so. Or custom size. And because the bokeh blur is quite slow, to be honest, like if you don't use OpenCL, and I cannot do that unfortunately because my system isn't compatible with this, that's mainly due to my crappy graphics card that I have here. So if you want to limit the effect, you can have a bounding box. So for example, if you only want to blur this point here, then you can add a bounding box image to limit the bokeh blur just to here. So if you don't need to calculate the whole image, then you can do that just for here. That will make the performance a bit better. And that brings me to another nice thing that we have, and that is if you go to matte, box mask or ellipse mask. So the downside is you cannot really see them, you just see the bounding box of these mask nodes. But I can move this over. Of course, ideally I could just grab that in the background here and then grab and move that. But you can also do it with these input fields of the box mask. And now I can use that to limit the effect of the bokeh blur just to this area. So now this is in focus and this is still blurred, but the point is that this is now much faster. So even if I would make the blur again to size 2, this calculates now much faster because it is limited to the size. Oh, by the way, another thing, if you have a Z buffer, for example, and normalize that, so if you have a grayscale image like I have here, then you can also use that as input for the size, but you have to enable the checkbox variable size that would then use this grayscale image as input to control the bokeh blur. So the values that are used here will now control the amount of bokeh, which in this case for some reason doesn't have any effect or doesn't even work. I don't know why. Could be that I have to use a color ramp between that and tweak the values. Oh, there we go. This is now doing something. So you can see that here, this is perfectly sharp and it gets more blurry here, because if you look at that, this is black. So that would mean there is no effect of bokeh blur. So that is the variable size for that. Okay, so this is the bokeh blur. Then there's a nice thing that is dilate and erode. This was one of the most important notes for the whole movie, because you probably know the step, this old behavior. So if you do that, then you can shrink the outline or the shapes here, for example, the alpha pass. But the behavior of that is not really nice. So it looks a bit bad. So there are now things that you can tweak. For example, there is a threshold value. So here you can tweak that. Maybe if I add a blur, for example, Gaussian blur, I don't know, 20 pixels. So now you can see a difference. So this is the step size and it looks very different from the threshold. So here you can tweak that in a different way. Then there's distance, which is also interesting. But the most important setting for us has been the feathering. So feathering has been coded by Campbell, and this was one of the most useful notes of the whole project. So because when we have been keying, often we would have to shrink or grow the masks to get rid of the edges. So now you can shrink that in a way that it doesn't just shrink, but it will also blur that. So instead of just making the edges or the shapes smaller, it will blur starting from the edge and then will blur to the inside, like so. So if you have a very large area, it will look a bit weird, but you have this nice feathering effect, and you can do that in both directions. You can make it smaller, or you can also blur to the outside. And the benefit compared to if you would use blur, of course, just to demonstrate that. So if we would have a 20 pixel blur of the alpha channel, then this would blur in both directions. So instead of just growing starting from the edge, it will blur in both directions. But here, if I make this 20 pixels, so this keeps the outline, but just feathers to the inside. And then you can have even more control by changing the fall off. So for example, if you set this from smooth to sphere, it will be different. So the sphere setting will be a bit more aggressive. So when you have, for example, something like 2 pixels with smooth, it won't have barely any effect. But if you set it to sphere, then you will really take something away here. So Dilate Erode, super handy and very nice. Well, then there's one very nice note, and that is despeckle. That is very handy for cycles renderings. So if you have fireflies, then the despeckle can help you get rid of that. Now currently I don't have a cycles render, and I believe that if I would switch to cycles and render that, I won't have any fireflies here. So let's see, maybe I can quickly come up with something. Okay, so there are a few fireflies, so these typical cycles noise, and if you want to get rid of them, you could try the despeckle node. So if I drag that in between here and look at that, then first it's nothing is happening, but you can tweak these values here, and in theory, yeah, this is now getting rid of these points. So here, the overall image doesn't really change, but this is taking away all these little dots. So if the fireflies are your main problem with your cycle render, then the despeckle node does a really good job in getting rid of them. But still, the main improvement for the new compositor is really the speed, and I want to demonstrate that by using one of the demo files from the movie. So this is the composite for the scene 8.3a. So this is the scene where old Tom is approaching the robot, going to hug it. So it is using multi-layer EXR, so I don't have to render anything because it's just using this image. So if I just control left click here, it's still taking a while because it's HD and it's using lots of blur nodes, but still it is reasonably fast. So there we go. And this is really quite nice. But still it could be faster because, for example, if I would do anything, I don't know, maybe here. So this is this main file, and I click here, that is fast. And then I want to do something, for example, add a gamma correction node, then move that in here, and then look at that. Now this really takes a while. So you can see it is still compositing and everything. So you might think, well, this is not as fast as it could be, even though it is reacting quite fast, but this is really slow. But the main improvement is that you can now tweak that. So now there are some options for performance enhancement, and you can find them down here in the performance tab in the sidebar. So if you have a computer that is supporting OpenCL, unfortunately mine doesn't do that, then you can activate this checkbox and it will then calculate the whole image using OpenCL. Maybe I can demonstrate that it actually changes something by making it fail, because for me using OpenCL always produces errors. So if I go here and then click on this node, there should be some weird results. So you can see there is something going wrong, so I have to disable that in order for it to work. But there's still other things that you can do for speed up. So for example, you can have quality options for rendering and for editing. So you could set the edit quality to low, and if I now make a refresh, it would be a little bit faster, but it will also just use the low quality settings. And these low quality settings you can see especially here in the blur. So basically it's mainly just the bokeh blur and filtering, and especially also the blur node and the defocus node that are using this quality option. So you could try the medium quality setting. So this is now a bit better and it is faster, but also if you use high, it will still be reasonably fast and editable. Okay, so now this is the final quality. Another thing that you can do is to change the chunk size, and that makes sense if you have lots of cores. So for example, if you use an 8-core machine with hyper-threading, then you would have 16 threads that you can calculate the image simultaneously. In that case, you might benefit from setting the chunk size to something smaller, for example 128 or 64. So if I don't know, if I click here and then here, So now you can see how this image is now calculated in chunks or in tiles. And this is also giving the name for this compositor. So this is the tile-based compositing. So the whole image is divided into tiles, into single tiles, and these tiles are then given to one of the cores and one tile per thread. So now that this image is now divided into several tiles, you can use all the cores that you have to calculate this image. But also distributing the processing power over all these tiles can generate some overhead. So if you don't have enough cores, it doesn't make sense to make the chunk size too small, because then you would just have to distribute the computing tasks over the tiles, and that is some overhead. One thing that is extremely handy is to make the nodes highlight. So if you want to debug what of the nodes are slow, then you can enable this option. Then you can see where Blender is calculating. So all of these that are blinking are taking a bit longer. So that's interesting for debugging, but really for us the most important thing was this option, two-pass rendering. So this was the wrong tooltip. So the two-pass thing is extremely handy, because that will make Blender first calculate everything that is fast, and after that everything that is slow. So if you just want to do some color changes, then you can force a redraw. So now everything is, well, there, all the blur didn't happen and all the dilated eroding. But if I now go ahead and add in some RGB curves here, then I can get a very quick result without having to wait for all the rest. Speaking of which, that's not quite true yet, because now if I change anything here, you can in fact see the preview or the result, but Blender is still finishing the whole composite, even though you might not want that. And the reason for that is that currently the end result is connected to the composite output. So, and I really suggest to disconnect that unless you really want to output your results, because then Blender will not calculate up to that node. If, for example, I connect my viewer node to this node with Control Shift click, then it will stop here. So the only thing that is now calculated is everything from this node tree up to that node that is now connected to the viewer node, and everything else will not be calculated. And that means that if I connect my viewer node here, all of this is now not being calculated. You can see that by not seeing any highlighting, and that is very, very handy. For example, to compare, if I connect it to the composite output again and then Control Shift click here, I can still see the output of this image, but Blender is nevertheless calculating everything up to the composite output, even though you might not even want to see that. So if you just tweak your node setup, then it's really nice to cut the connection to the composite output, because it will save you some time. Unless, and that's very important as well, unless you have a node preview somewhere here. So for example, if you have the mix node, if you have the mix node, then you have this little node preview here. And Blender will calculate this preview even though you might not have the composite output enabled. So if I now click here, Blender will first show me the results up to this node, but will still calculate everything else just in order to be able to display this little preview here. And I mean, that's stupid. I mean, why would you need that? And that's why there is this option to hide the preview. So of course you can just select everything, A, and then hit Shift H to either show or hide all the previews of the nodes, or if you just want to do it for the active node, then select it and hit Shift H to toggle the preview. But if you decide that you don't need the preview at all, then you can enable this option, and then if you add a new node, it will not have the preview. So these are the main options how you can speed up compositing, but there's even more. So for example, one thing that we did before we had the two-pass option was to use the switch node. So with the switch node, you can bypass certain parts of a node tree. So for example, I have here the bokeh blur, and let's say I want to edit my whole image, but without using the bokeh blur, just for the speed, but still I would want to have a blurred image in the background. Well, the usual blur, fast Gaussian or the Gaussian blur, is still way faster than bokeh blur. So what you could do is you can divide your node tree by adding the switch node. So Shift A and then go to layout and then use the switch. And then I put in my output image that comes from here into the bokeh blur. Hang on. I put the output of the bokeh blur into the on of the switch node, and then go from here to hue saturation value. And if I now switch this node to on, this will be calculated. If I turn it off, it won't. So what I can do is to add one of the faster filters, so blur and then flat or fast Gaussian or Gaussian or whatever you like. So one of them that is maybe a bit faster. So I put in the image here into the blur, then say relative, make it fit to the Y coordinates, and then say for example 2% blur. So I control shift click here, that is the blurred image. Maybe I can even disable 2-pass for now. So this is the blurred image, this is the bokeh image. So you can see bokeh is way slower as blur. So blur is quite fast. So I can put this into the switch node now, and if I click here, I have a blurred image that is reasonably fast. My whole node tree will be quite fast now. So I can have the end result with blurred background, but still be quite fast. I think I should delete this demo mix node. So this is now my result, and it's using the blur node to calculate this part of the node tree. But if I enable this button, it will switch to the bokeh blur. And that works because the new compositor works from back to front. So the calculations will start here, and then Blender will go and put all the nodes to the tiles. So this will now calculate here, and then we'll go there. It will also simultaneously calculate this way of the node tree. Everything here will be calculated, but then once it goes to the switch node, it will now either go this way past the node tree, or it will go this way through the bokeh blur. So that is very handy, and you can bypass whole node trees. So for example, let's say you have, I don't know, whatever, switch. You want to test something, you can even put this in here and then either calculate everything with the whole node tree, so including this part with the robot, or you can also say no, it should be just taking the image from back here, put this here. And now if I go here, the lower part is switched off and it's taking the input from over here. If I switch it on, it will go this way through all the complete node tree. So that is very handy and a nice way to speed up your composites. And then lastly, one thing that you will find in all of our composites, or in most of them, of the DVD, is the frame node. So we are making use of them here, and you can barely see them. That has to do with my preset, so that is just my messed up user preferences. So to see the frame nodes better, I go to my user prefs, and then in the themes, I go to the node editor, and then have the frame node and can set the alpha value to maybe 30% or something like this. So now I can see this frame node a bit better, and the frame node is not doing anything except for organizing my node tree. If I delete that with X, nothing changes really in the effect of the composite, but the layout is different. So now I have all these nodes separately, and I can drag them with B, box select, and then move them around. But now if I want to move this whole tree, I always have to first box select them, or I would just drag single nodes. So the nice thing about the frame node is that I can now select all these nodes and then hit Ctrl J for join, and they will be joined into this frame node, which is really just for the layout. And then I can even give this frame node a name. For example, this is the robot, and then also added the label size. Usually I use 60 because you can see it better. And then if you want to, you can also add a custom color. So you can make it brighter or green or blue, whatever you like. So this is a very nice way of organizing node trees. And you can also have frames in frames. So if I select the RGB curves now and hit Ctrl J, they will be inside of a frame node. Now I can just delete this frame, but let's say you have this hue saturation value node and you don't want to want it to be part of the frame, because currently it will always be inside the frame, and if you move it, it will also grow or shrink the frame. If you want to detach it, you can press Alt F for frame, D-frame, so Alt F, and it will snap out of the frame and be separately. Now if you want to move it back, you could just G, drag it into the frame, and once you let go, it will be part of this frame node, and there we go. So Alt F to deframe that. Now one more thing, and that is that you can now have a reroute node. So if I shift left click and drag here, I will add this root or reroute node, and it's basically it's just a thing that divides my line between these two nodes, and I can organize it in a way that maybe looks a bit more tidy. So if I don't want to have this line going all the way through all these nodes, I just shift left click and drag here, divide that and organize that in a way that looks maybe a bit more tidy. You can also add them with shift A, you go to layout, then use the reroute, and we'll add this little point, and with G you can now drag it into or onto this line, let go, and then you have it here. And the other nice thing is that if you want to have multiple connections, you can also do that. So from here, I left click and drag to drag this noodle out of this node and can connect it also to multiple outputs. You can also get rid of them by selecting them and then Ctrl X to delete them out of this line, but without cutting the connection. So select it and then Ctrl X to get rid of that. So I think these are most of the new features. I hope I didn't forget anything. And just by saying that, I realize I forgot something, and that is you have snapping. So this is another thing that makes things or can make things a bit more tidy. So you can enable incremental snapping. So if I duplicate this node and move it, it will now move not smoothly, but it will move in steps if I hold down the Control key. Otherwise, I can also enable snapping to the grid. So now G will just move in steps like this, or you deactivate that and hold down the Control key, just like in the 3D viewport, will also move in steps. So if I now duplicate this and hold down the Control key, I will have it in a line. If you don't need the incremental steps, then you can also snap to the node itself. So one thing that I find very handy is to snap to the y-axis. So if I select this node and duplicate it, move it around, nothing happens. But if I now, while I am in move mode, hold down the Control key, I can snap to the line. So that is a very nice feature. And then lastly, one thing that is also very nice and that many people have been wishing forever is that you can now copy the complete node tree to a different file. Well, you cannot really do it from one file or from one Blender to another Blender, but I can now click A, then Control C to copy everything, then open up a new file. And then if I now go to the compositor, it will, if I press Ctrl V, it will paste the whole node tree, theoretically at least, Okay, so you have to enable use notes, and then you can import the whole node tree. But of course, you saw this little error up here. You cannot use the render layers. Of course, this is now not working, so all the image links are lost. But it's better than nothing, because now I have this whole layout and can work with that. So of course, that's very handy if you have similar scenes, but of course different files, then you can copy that from one file to the other. And that now concludes this little introduction to the new compositor.